Hello everybody, my name is Walter, and this is the first episode of my Redstone Whistleblowing series. In this episode, I will explain to you how my compact and fast tree-trunk harvester, which I showed you in a previous tutorial, works in detail. Now, if you haven't already watched the introduction for the Redstone Whistleblowing series, I would recommend first watching that one, since in there I explained how you can actually make suggestions for the second episode. But with that out of the way, let's get started with the tree-trunk harvester you can see here. So before we get into the gritty details, let's quickly show you how this thing here works and let's explain what it does. So this is basically a major component of my tree farms and it is responsible for growing the tree and harvesting the central pillar of wood blocks. So let's show this in action. Basically all you need to do is place the sapling in there, that gets detected, then bone mealed, that gets detected, and then a rising sand pillar will start to push that central pillar of wood blocks upwards, where it then gets transported via a smart piston system into some kind of storage or maybe blast chamber system. That is what this build here does as a whole. Now as you can see, I already color coded the entire build quite a bit, and each color here basically represents a subfunction which is needed for this whole thing here to work. And in the following, I will go through those different systems, explain how they work and how they interact with each other. So let's start with the circuit at the very center of this build, which is the one that creates a rising sand pillar. Before we get to the actual circuit, let's talk about the theory behind it. Basically, what the circuit needs to be able to do is pulling a sand block from the side into a rising sand pillar without the sand pillar destabilizing. Destabilizing means that the sand block at this position detects an air block below it, starts to fall, and then obviously at the wrong moment those pistons here will fire and break that sand into a falling item, which is something we obviously don't want at all in our build. This is especially a problem in 1.14 and later, where they changed the way that falling sand behaved and made it very fragile. The only reliable and fast way I know about to do such thing is this configuration you can see here, with a normal piston and a sticky piston in this configuration there, both powered via one tick pulses, and the normal piston one tick before the sticky piston. And if you do that, what happens is first the normal piston pushes the sand upwards, then while it's retracting, the sticky piston extends. In this case, the piston arms can somewhat overlap if one is extending and the other is retracting at the moment. Now this piston extends, pulls back or connects to this sand block there and pulls back. And that's what you can see here. By the way, I'm using commands to summon in a fresh sand block here and to also remove the sand block up there, as you can see there. Now this whole thing here can run at different speeds. The speed I'm using for my build is one block or one activation every four game ticks. Every four redstone ticks. You can also do this every three redstone ticks. But there is one issue, as we will see in a moment. Before that, let's show you how this works in this system here. Now I need one activation every four game ticks. I would be able to do this in different ways, but the easiest one I was able to figure out is using this configuration here. So I basically have a observer clock which activates every two redstone ticks, and I'm running this into a two tick repeater. And this results in the repeater turning on and off with a four tick cycle. Since a two tick activation of a repeater is only detected once by those observers here, we also only get one activation out of those observers here for each activation of this repeater here. So in total we get a four tick cycle going on at the end here. So one tick active, three tick deactive. And that's how the system here works. Now the reason I'm going with a four tick cycle and not a three tick cycle is pretty straightforward and has to do with how smart pistons work. A normal smart piston, like you can see here, only works with one block every four ticks. So This is the maximum frequency the system here can be activated. If I give it a 3-tick cycle, you will see the smart piston is too slow for the system and the system will break down. If I turn off the smart piston, you can see the system down here can actually work with a 3-tick system or 3-tick per block frequency. But the smart piston cannot do this. I actually measured this to be sure, so this is truly a 3-tick which this system can work up to, and a 4-tick cycle which I need to use for the system to work properly. Now, why is that so important? Pretty straightforward. The blocks I'm pushing with the sand pillar, so the wood blocks, need to be transported somewhere. And unless I'm using instantaneous or supercharged smart pistons, I can't go faster than what those smart pistons can go, and that's those 4-tick cycles. Also, the block storage system I'm usually using for my tree farms also can only work for up to one block every 4 redstone ticks. So that's where this limitation comes from. So now that we know the theory, let's go to the actual circuit. So as you can see here, this component here, or this circuit, actually contains two such rising sand pillars. The first is fed from a kind of block storage, and the second is fed from the first rising sand pillar. This fulfills two functions. The first is we can have some kind of block storage at the bottom and still have the last piston which pushes the final sand pillar upwards as close to the surface as possible. Or in other words, we can have the space where the tree grows as high as possible, such getting more wood for less bone meal, which is obviously quite useful. The second advantage is that if we were to simply remove this piston, for example by pulling it back with another sticky piston, this sand pillar here can fall into this central space and then pulled into the various block storages, as you will see at a later point. The rest of this build follows the same principle as this demonstrator there. We have our observer clock, which is turned on and off via a piston. Then, in this case, we're using those node blocks here to trigger the observers at the bottom here, which with the correct delays trigger the normal and the sticky piston. Up here, we have pretty much the same. We are powering via one of the sand blocks in this column the bottom piston, and then a tick later we are powering the sticky piston up there. The reason this is built in this way was that we actually needed to fit it into this kind of space here so that we were still able to have a usable user interface where we can actually walk up to this space here even if there is a leaf crusher system on top. So anyway, that is this transportation system. Now let's talk about where those sand blocks come from, because that is another thing I need to go in detail about. Up to this point, I use command blocks to directly replace the sand block here at the very bottom, which was directly fed into this rising sand pillar. That had a very simple reason, and that is that the falling sand pillar is actually too slow to feed this system. The reason is pretty simple. This sand pillar needs one tick to detect that it can fall down. It needs another tick to actually fall down, and it goes into the third tick to actually turn back into a block that can be pulled via piston. So if I were to feed this with a sand pillar, you can see only every second cycle, every other cycle, we are actually able to pull a new block into our sand pillar. And as you can see, due to the off timing, the sand pillar also starts to break down, which is obviously something we need to avoid. So how can you resolve that issue? It's pretty straightforward. You don't use just one sand pillar, you use several and you alternate between those sand pillars. In this build here, I'm using three sand pillars plus the central block as a storage system, which makes in this setup here a total of 12 blocks I can pull into the system and create a sand pillar up to this point over there. And I'm basically alternating between those pillars. So I'm first pushing, obviously first removing this block, then I'm pushing in this block, then this block, then this block, and so on, until all blocks have been fed into the system. And parallel to this feeding, I'm obviously using this system here to pull those blocks one after the other into the rising sand pillar. And that has two advantages. The first is that we can feed the system fast enough without breaking any blocks. And the second is that the overall build is a lot smaller, or at least not as high. Because basically we need to move 12 blocks. If we just have a single sand pillar, that means we need 12 blocks free headspace, which makes it quite tricky and big. With those three sand pillars, that is only 4 blocks. So we are a lot smaller than before. Obviously the circuitry around it is a bit more complex, but overall the build becomes smaller. So let's have a look at this feeding mechanism. So basically what we have here is one big loop where we essentially have, once the system is activated, a one tick pulse running through this loop here. Between those three pistons, it's always a delay of 4 ticks, and the same is also true between those two. So we have each pillar pushing in the lowest block with a 4 tick delay in between each, and basically 12 tick delay for each pillar itself. So by far long enough for the sand to settle down and be able to push the next block in. Now, that obviously needs to stop at some point, because as you have seen before, if the system runs dry, it starts to actually destroy the sand pillar. So we need to stop once all 12 blocks have been fed into the system. Or, in other words, once this system here has cycled 3 times. Now there's a simple way to do that, and that is to actually count the activations or the cycles the pulse has gone through the system. So basically, what we have here is a dropper-based or a hopper-dropper-based timer or counter, which, once it gets locked, counts 3 cycles until the dropper is empty, essentially, and then powers this piston, which disconnects or breaks up this big loop here. And if you want to reset the entire thing, all we need to do is depower the hopper again, and now the entire system is set again. So if we activate it again, you will see we get exactly 4 loops out of the system, and then it stops again. So that is how this feeding mechanism works. This also fulfills a second function, and that is that it also counts or detects when the feeding is finished, which means for the rest of the entire system to start resetting, because now the sand pillar has been produced or created completely and can now be retracted and stored again. But you will see in the corresponding circuit at the later part. So what happens during the actual resetting of the system here? The first is obviously that this block here, this piston here, gets pulled towards the side, and now those sand blocks from the raised sand pillar can fall down into the central area. So at some point you will end up with something like this here, a 12 block high sand pillar. Now we need to store them back into those three sand pillars. And that is done via those three piston columns or pillars, which then are activated one after the other with the correct timing so that the blocks are pulled back, the rest of the sand can fall down and settle, and then and only then the next blocks are pulled back. So as you can see, that is basically what the system here does, and you end up with two sand pillars with four, one with three, and then in the center a single sand block, which is the starting configuration this system down here works. What you also can see here is that those lowest three pistons here actually fulfill a double role. They are the pistons that pull in or push in the blocks that are fed into the rising sand pillar, and they also pull back the lowest blocks into the sand storage again. So that was one of the slightly more trickier ways to actually get those double functionality in there without actually getting any issues with the rest of the circuit. And as you also can see, those two circuits are both activated by a piston extending or retracting. So this is also a place where essentially parts of the circuitry fulfill a double role. And this is also the reason why this part here, which is actually just a rather long delay, is such a strange form, because it had to feed into or fit into this area here. So as you can see here, it fits right around the part of the control for the block transportation. It also fits right into the free space around the feeding mechanism, and that's the reason for this rather strange circuit right there. So now you should have at least a rough idea of how this sand pillar is actually created and also reset. But there is still one more component to the sand pillar, which I haven't really talked about in detail yet. And that is removing the dirt block from the place where the sand pillar is actually rising. Or otherwise we would start with moving the dirt block into our storage system, which obviously is not something we want. And second, we need for the reset to pull back this piston here. And that's what this circuit here is for. Now, basically, once we depower this block, the dirt block is retracted and the normal piston here is pushed into the correct position to actually start with the rising sand pillar. Now, if we power this block again, you will see that this piston retracts immediately, but the dirt block stays retracted for a long time. The reason is pretty straightforward. We need to wait until the sand pillar actually has fallen down and pulled back into the storage areas. And only then we can pull or plug in the hole at the top by pushing in the dirt block again. The way this is done is by simply using a hopper-based timer, where simply the amount of items inside of this hopper here determine how much longer this dirt block here remains retracted. So with that, we know pretty much everything about the components that are needed to create the sand pillar. Now let's talk about the rest of this build. Let's start with the detection part. So basically we need a circuit that is able to detect when a sapling is placed and when it is grown into a tree. Now you may think to use an observer to detect the growth of the tree, but the problem is that the saplings have different growth stages, and it's quite possible that when you are bone meaning it, you get different number of activations for each tree, depending on basically random chance. So even if you were to use some kind of counting mechanism, that would not work reliably. The only reliable function or circuit I was able to come up with is a block update detector. In this case, since I want to have a smooth surface area, I went with a system that you can see here that uses a normal piston with a full block to the face and then following that a few transparent blocks, and then another normal piston opposite of that. So how does this thing here work? Basically, this piston is currently powered, but it's not in a extended state, so it's butt powered essentially. If it gets a block update, it will extend. This block here, once it's in position, will disconnect this line here, which will unpower this piston again, so it will retract. At the same time, it unpowers that torch down there, which after a one tick delay powers this piston. So it pushes all of that backwards. This connection is opened up again. The piston is powered, but this piston remains powered for one tick longer until the torch turns off again. So this piston here is once more in a butted state, as you can see here. That's basically how this thing here works. Now the torch essentially remains powered for only one tick, which means that if you use a sticky piston, you have a very simple T flip-flop design here, which then is used to trigger in the rest of the system, but we will come to that at the moment. Now, what is this part at the front here for? Basically, this is connected to this dirt removing part here, or dirt retracting part. And basically, as long as the dirt is retracted, this block here is unpowered. And that means that this piston here is powered. Now, what does this mean? Basically, now the block update detector is deactivated. This is important because when the sand pillar is rising and this block update detector is not blocked, it would activate every time the sand pillar rises or falls again. And that is obviously something we also want to avoid, because that would re-trigger the entire system, and that's obviously a problem. So that's what this part here is for. Now that's the detection part. Next, we have this part here, which is just a comparator clock, which triggers this observer, which then triggers over a little extension, this dropper and the dispenser on top of it. And this is just a simple bone milling system. So what it does is the dispenser bone meals the sapling, the dropper replaces the used up bone meal, the hopper replaces the bone meal in the dropper, and also replaces its own stores from the chest on top. So that way you can transport quite easily the bone meal from this chest into the dispenser. And as you can see, it looks quite nice in the overall build. So that's the bone milling system. So as you can see, that is how this thing here works. And with that, let's get to the last circuit, which is this thing here. Now it may look quite intimidating, but it's essentially just an RS knowledge with some circuits or some signal lines that connect the different outputs of that RS knowledge with the different other redstone circuits I've shown you previously. The RS knowledge itself is just those two droppers, which are facing each other and have just a single item within them. Depending on which dropper contains that item, we are either in the harvesting mode, where the sand pillar is being created, or we are in the reset and idle mode, where the sand pillar is deconstructed and the system basically waits for the next sapling to be placed. Let's start with the inputs for the RS knowledge. The first input, which puts this entire thing into the harvesting mode, is actually directly connected to the growing system. So when the thing here is in the growing system mode, you see that this comparator clock here is running. Now, due to the way this works, this block here always has at least a signal strength of 1, as long as this clock is running. Once the clock is turned off, the signal strength goes back to 0 again. Next to that block, we have a sticky piston. The sticky piston doesn't really matter whether it gets a one signal strength or a signal strength of 15 or whatever, it will extend. And only once the growth system turns off, so the tree essentially has been grown, the sticky piston will retract again. That means that now the observer on top will also trigger, and since droppers are butt-powered, or can be butt-powered, this dropper here will fire and push the item into the bottom dropper. So we have set the system. Now the entire system starts to go into the harvesting mode. The reset is connected to this counter of the feeding mechanism. So if you remember back, we have this pulse going in cycles, and once it has reached the third cycle and starts the fourth one, this clock here, or this counter here, detects that, breaks up the loop, and stops the system here from feeding new blocks. Now, at the same time, this torch here, is this one here, also triggers or powers this piston. So when we are resetting, this piston here powers and triggers this observer, which powers the bottom dropper, which then moves the block up into the top dropper again. So that's basically how this RS knowledge is reset again. And as you can see, all of those outputs here have toggled their state once more. And now basically the whole thing here goes into the reset mode, and after that waits for the next input or the next sampling to be placed. Now, where are the different interfaces or the different connections? This part down here is directly connected to the RS knowledge, and yellow leads to the activation of our transportation system. Down here, we have the control for the locking and unlocking of our clock. Counter. Up here, we have the connection to the sand, to the dirt retraction, and the preparation of the sand transportation. And via the system, also to the blocking of the detection system. And over here, we alternate between starting the feeding mechanism and starting the storing of the sand blocks. And all of those components work together to get this whole thing here working. Now, if you have watched carefully, you will have noticed that I have left out two colors up to this point, and that are the white and the purple. Those are not really part or not really required for this whole thing here to work. They are more interfaces to the other components, which are usually part of my tree farms. Let's start with the purple one. The purple one is used to trigger the leaf crusher system. So it is just a straightforward output from the RS knowledge. If we go in harvesting mode, the leaf crusher system is triggered. Pretty straightforward. The white one is a bit more interesting. So in this system here, I'm also using it to have a button in here, which I wasn't able to fit in any other way, but it is actually more used, or the main reason for this is to actually control the system and to suppress the activation of the harvesting mode. This is important when the storage system has been filled up to the brim, because this system here will break if the blocks start to back up. So once the block storage system is full, and then your transportation system is full, and then at some point your sand column will not be able to rise again, or rise anymore, and at that point the system here will break partially. So What I usually build into my tree farms is some kind of detection system, which detects a full storage system and then stops the system here from being activated. And how is it done here? It's pretty straightforward. All we need to do is actually constantly power this piston, because as long as it cannot retract, we can go into the harvesting mode. And that's the whole thing. Additionally, once the whole thing here goes back into the normal mode, it gets activated. So even if a tree has been grown but wasn't able to be harvested, it will then automatically start to harvest this. And that's what those components of the circuit does and how they interact with each other. And lastly, I want to show you a simplified schematic of the overall build to give you simply a different point of view. Maybe some of you have an easier way to understand how everything fit together by looking at this here. So this is a simplified schematic insofar that it only contains the delays that are truly needed for the function of the entire build. And it also summarizes parts of the functions as simple blocks. One example would be the block transportation, so the part that actually creates the rising sand pillar, which is just a simple block here, since it would not really help anymore to go more in detail about this, since it has just a single input which either turns it on or off, and nothing else interesting going on there. Anyway, let's go through the different parts so you can get a feeling of what everything does. By the way, the colors I'm using for the arrows here are the same as the wool colors in the rest of this video. Anyway, the first part up there is the detection part. So the block update detector, which detects when a sapling is placed and when it is grown into a tree. The inhibition part is the suppression of the bud, so also pretty straightforward. Now the T flip-flop determines the growth mode. So we can either be in a growth mode where the bone milling system is running on the clock, or we can trigger the harvesting mode. And the harvesting mode is pretty much just the state of the RS knowledge. This RS knowledge is obviously connected to pretty much the rest of the entire circuit and controls what everything does. The first thing that it does is obviously it retracts the dirt block. The pulse extender here is to make sure that the dirt block remains extended for long enough to later on retract the entire sand pillar again. And thus also to keep the detector blocked for long enough. Then we have the block transportation system, so the pistons that actually transport the sand blocks into a rising pillar. Next up, we have the feeding mechanism, which has those three block storages where it feeds the sand blocks into the block transportation system, one after the other. And essentially, this is just a big loop with three delays in there so that it alternates between the different block feeding mechanisms. Additionally to that, we have our counter, which counts how many loops the system has done. And once the system has four loops, it stops the system from running further, so it suppresses that system, and it also turns off the harvesting mode again. Once the harvesting mode is off, the clock itself gets resetted and our block storage system comes into play. So our block storage system then starts to remove one pillar after the other from the falling sand pillar. Lastly, after the sand pillar has been removed again, the detector gets unlocked and the whole system is back and waiting for the next sapling to be placed. Now, since we have two flip-flops in here, the whole system can be in four different states or four different modes. The first is a reset or idle mode. This is when the sand pillar is being deconstructed or when the system is simply waiting for a sapling to be placed. Then we have a growing mode. So this means that we are currently bone milling our sapling. Then we have the harvesting mode, so the tree has been grown and now we are
running the entire system to create our sand pillar. And the last mode is a mode where we are growing and harvesting at the same time, which is actually a forbidden mode. So this is a faulty mode, or a mode that only can be achieved by not being careful with the system, for example by triggering the detector a third time, by placing a block for example, before the system can lock the detector. This can have some unfortunate issues with the system at least making more noise than necessary, and is something to avoid, but usually you won't be able to actually get into that mode, because the detector, which can actually or controls the growing mode, is locked as long as you're harvesting. But anyway, that is the overall circuit as a simplified schematic.
And with that, we have finally reached the end of this episode about how my compact and fast tree trunk harvester works in detail. Please let me know if you want more episodes like this here, or if you think this is a complete waste of time. Also, let me know if you have suggestions for the next episode. And, well, I hope you nevertheless enjoyed this episode, and, well, see ya!